Mic check, 1, 2, 1, 2. Give it up one time, Mr. Patrick Jerome. Come on now, TJ, an entire movie filmed in Haitian Creole?
It's so hard to make a movie.
People don't understand that 2,700 films submitted, and they might pick 100. You know, which of the 100 out of them are they going to pick?
There are so many creative people involved.
For a filmmaker to make a movie and then to have it selected to be part of the festival, it's a big honor.
Boom! You don't know what to expect.
What's your favorite part of the festival?
Oh, I love the red carpet. I may never come
out. I love watching movies.
Really good ones.
We're the little film that can't.
It was made with a lot of confidence.
I'm super excited.
And this is what we are all about, help them support their vision to the world.
If we did that, we did our job.
Joining me for this segment of Basic Talk is internationally acclaimed independent filmmaker, Mr. Patrick Jerome.
CJ, thanks for having me. You know, I'm so pleased to be on the show and to talk to your audience about my journey.
Born in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, you went from being a wanted man hiding from the government in Haiti to becoming one of the most powerful voices in independent film. Pat, how does that happen?
Well, I made a movie in Haiti, and it's called Woodless Gang, which is available right now on Amazon Prime. So I was, you know, I wrote it as a teenager, not expecting, you know, the turn that ended up happening, because the country had went to a democratic election, democratic presidents in office. And then a few months later, there was a military coup against the democratic president that was sent to exile. And then, of course, there's a wave of repression that started in society. And that's when they came after me, because I had made the world premiere of my movie on September 22nd, 1991. And then 8 days later, September 30th, there was the military coup. So the country went upside down. And of course, anybody that had to do that had something to do with freedom and, you know, producing and promoting something that appears to be, you know, a clear voice, a free, you know, voice in society, ended up getting in trouble. But of course, I was so young, it was hard for me to believe. So I went through a bunch of nightmares, living in Haiti, in hiding for 1 year and a half until, you know, I had the opportunity to leave the country with political asylum. So, you know, because of the film, you know, so that's, you know, that's what happened, you know, in terms of, you know, historical fact, in terms of, you know, what that my first feature film in Haiti or in my life brought me, basically. I usually get inspired by true events, you know, real stories. And, you know, if it's not a true story, or it can be a story based on true events.
Right.
So that kind of guide my career entirely to produce, because I'm a screenwriter first.
Mm-hmm.
So starting from Haiti to make a movie about the gangsters that were going into people's houses, killing people, and then I made my first feature film about it, which got me in trouble. As I mentioned earlier, it's because the movie is based on, you know, something that was going on in society.
Mm-hmm.
And the movie kind of, you know, put it in the spotlight from my own observation, you know, as a young Haitian. So that's, you know, that's the start. And then my first feature film in the United States, Deportation, which was because I had worked here, you know, as I come to the United States to start over my life as a social worker, a case worker for Haitian refugees and then for the American Red Cross. So I ended up, you know, being exposed to a bunch of stories and cases. So that's how I came across the story about deportation. And then I ended up writing the story about it, and that was my first feature film in the U.S., you know? So, but that goes on and on and on. All this, those big list of movies that you see, they're all inspired by, you know, true events, you know, or true stories, you know? And I mean, especially, I mean, when you look at a movie like Anatomy of a Saga, which is based on mass shooting. So we made the movie in 2009. We had no idea, like, you know, it would become such a problem, you know, in this country, you know, all those mass shooting that ended up happening, you know. And then you go to movies like Holler at Me, you know, which was, you know, distributed by Image Entertainment, was a movie that, I mean, a friend of mine who was working on a, I was working on a movie for him. As we were filming, there was a young black actor who got shot, you know, prior for me to do the editing. And then it just bring to mind, like, oh my goodness, those killers, do they have a conscience, you know? So that's why I ended up writing the story about a hitman haunted by his conscience. So, you know, it all goes on and on and on and on, you know, just to give you the source of, you know, inspiration that I have in terms of bringing those stories together.
Thankfully, painfully, and creatively so.
You have to be creative. Of course, when you write a script, it ended up taking a life on its own. After you put the movie together, because, you know, the acting, wherever you cast to play some parts, you know, in it, the location and the means that you have to do it, like the budget, all that kind of influence the outcome, you know, of the story. You know, one of my best recognitions that I had is my movie Against the Jab, for example, with Leon. When I wrote that script, I had Leon in mind, because I saw him playing Little Richard in that movie, in that HBO film. And I'm like, damn, this guy is so talented. He definitely can play that DJ on the radio. Actually, we used to have those radio shows where they call people on, you know,
the prank callers,
yeah, the prank phone calls. And there were lots of stories. So I ended up writing that script having him in mind. And we ended up getting him to play, you know, the role for real, you know. And then it goes on, you know, and then I had Lonette Mackey, you know, to join the cast. You know, it's just amazing, like, people you've been seeing on the screen growing up, you know. And then I saw a movie on Netflix with this Spanish actress, Clara Lago, that I was so amazed by it. And then I reached out, you know, for her, and then it came through. So that was one of the perfect casting, you know, that I was so happy that, you know, we brought this story together, you know, as I wanted it, you know, because usually you would write a script, you have so many different performers in mind. But of course, with your budget, usually that's the limitation that would preventing you from getting, you know, your potential cast, you know, your dream cast.
Exactly.
You know, and put it in that level. So, you know, so that's what goes on throughout the productions. You know, sometimes, you know, you get surprised with people who say, okay, let's work together. You know, like I work with Fred Williamson, for example, in Beyond Control. And, you know, it was such a pleasure working with him, because, you know, that's another actor once again. You know, you're watching them growing up. And then when you get a chance to work with them, you just, you know, you just feel like, you know, that you achieve something by just having them part of your cast, you know?
Cinema is just a natural extension of who you are. You grew up with storytelling and music around you. How do you so masterfully take those Haitian memories and make it into something anybody can enjoy? How do you do that?
That's a nice way to put it, you know? I made movies that so many people ended up connecting with, and which is good, because if you look at my movie Impression, for example.
Say it again. I love how you say that. Say it again. Say it like three more times. Say it three more times.
My movie Impression.
Oh, I love it.
Actually, it's Impression is more like an Haitian Creole way of saying it, but in English it will be Impression. But the original title is Impression, because I wanted to make sure that we make the entire film in Haitian Creole. The subtitle, of course. So this movie actually ended up playing at the Showcase Cinema. And then we have so many foreigners, like people, you know, who are not Haitian. They just had the subtitles because it was playing, you know, with, you know, with, you know, it was a regular kind of release, you know, in that theater. So the way the people react to this story was amazing because, you know, that's when I saw the general approach to it, you know, which is good as a screenwriter. If you can make a story and write a story that can, you know, cross over to any culture, those themes that anybody can relate to, because we all get affected by love, by passion, by, you know, any strong, you know, emotions that cannot tie us together as human beings. You know, whether you can do something to make people cry or you do something that make people laugh, you ended up or scare them, you know, through a movie, you ended up play with their emotion. So that's one of the things that I like about my career. I managed to make films that, you know, that people can relate to and people connect, you know, with those, you know, productions. As you mentioned about my aunt, you know, I discovered my storytelling skills at a very young age. I was, you know, around 8 or 9 years old when she came from the countryside, and, you know, in the evening we just gathered together, and then every night she would tell, you know, a different tale, a different story. So after she left, and my brothers, my sibling, you know, my sisters and my friends were all in the backyard, and then they were complaining or saying, oh my goodness, she's gone. Now who's going to tell the next story? And I just want to tell myself and says, okay, I'm going to tell the story tonight. So, and everybody gathered and listening to me, it was just spontaneous. I just put, you know, story together and keep telling it and keep, you know, going and keep going, you know, just like that, you know, like improvising. And they were like glued sitting and listening to me, you know, amazingly. And then it lasts, you know, after, and you know, one day after another, they keep on asking me during the day, oh, we can't wait, what story that you're going to tell us tonight? So just to let you know, at a very young age, I just discovered that, because I was, you know, facing that little experience, you know, with storytelling, and that stays with me. And then I started to write, and I went to a movie theater for the first time. I was 12 years old, and I was traumatized. After I saw this film, it was a karate film with a lot of violence, where they kill somebody, somebody's family, they burn his house. And I was so traumatized, and I was sharing that experience with a friend of mine. He says to me, no, not all movies are like that. Let's go back to the theater, you know, another day. So a week later, I went back to the theater, and I saw a different movie, which was with Clint Eastwood with that little monkey. And I was like, oh, wow, this is different. This is interesting. And then 3 months later, I says, you know what? This is what I want to do. Awesome. I want to make a film.
So you are the creator of B-Way 7 Productions.
Yes.
Through B-Way 7, you have the ability to create what you envision. Tell us how you started the company.
Well, I shot a film in Haiti, my very first movie, which was compressed for complex. That I shot the film. I had no idea how I was going to edit the film. So I just had this high passion, this drive. I just go ahead and get some actors together, and I shot it. After I was done, like, damn, how am I going to edit the film? And then all of a sudden, there was somebody who came to Haiti and saying that he's going to put a film school together. So I signed up. I went to take those classes. And when I started, and I find out it doesn't have anything to do with film editing, with movie, you know, production. It was all video production. Some people were talking about producing wedding videos and so on. But anyway, I just, you know, learned how to do edits, and I was exposed to it. And I had my own equipment and so on in terms of video camera that my father had bought me. So that kind of gave me a start. So right after that, I take those classes, I met some guys there. There were 7 of us. So seven of us, that's why you said it says B-Way 7 Productions.
I knew there was a story behind it. I knew there was. I don't know the B-Way, but I said either it took him 7 years to create it, or
no, there were
he dropped seven cameras or something.
There were seven of us, but guess what? B-Way, in Haitian Creole, it's Boy. Boy means boys.
Seven boys, I got you.
It's like the Seven Boys Productions.
So, yeah, have me speaking Creole around here, Pat, in a minute.
So that's where this is where the name came from.
Wow.
So the Seven Boys Productions, so it's B-Way 7 Productions. But when I came to the U.S., as soon as people see B-Way, they say Broadway. As soon as people, and then I keep fighting it and keep fighting it, and then it get to a point, we had to open a distribution site who says, wait a minute, why don't we call it Broadway Pictures Entertainment? Because people already referred to B-Way as Broadway, so we're already there. Let's just use it that way for our new, our corporation.
You see how that just manifests itself?
So that's, that's the story,
Your movie, Against the Jab, currently available for rental, Amazon, iTunes. You can see it on YouTube, on demand. What would you recommend for someone starting out? Some definite do's and don'ts for promoting your project in social media.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned Against the Jab, because I had movies before, like Haul at Me, that was released by Image Entertainment, and Walls Have Ears with Indieflix, and it goes on and on and on. But with my experience in having my movies available on VOD with Against the Jab, that was a very interesting process, because VOD was kind of new. Mm-hmm. Still new, but, in 2014, it was definitely, the new thing, the new way to go. Mm-hmm. One thing that we find out is that we spend a lot of time saying to people, promoting it, do the marketing, saying the movie will be available on such and such date, like 3, 4, 6 months prior to the release. And as you get closer, it just died completely. So when the movie actually really become available, and then now we find out that you have to do another campaign to let people know, because the world that we live in today, it's like if I'm telling you I have a movie to anybody right now, their first reaction is, oh, I'm going to watch it this weekend. Oh, I'm going to watch it tonight.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one thing we learn about, online, distribution, VOD, and so on. It's just like as the movie become available, that's when you start doing the promotion.
Yeah. Is there anything that Patrick Jerome hasn't done? Is there a book that we should be on the look for? Is there an album? Because we know you sing and you're very good. Is there an album that we need to keep our eyes peeled for?
That's a good question. I have a short story book coming out soon, The Edge of Perception. That actually is supposed to be out, but I had been so busy with so many different productions. And my editor was busy working on two different books, and I didn't want to switch to somebody else. So I had been very patient waiting for her to finish it. So The Edge of Perception, short stories, because I wrote so many short story films. I mean, in general. So I decided to do that, to share with the world. So that is coming. Very soon I will have some update, let's say in about 2 or 3 months, in terms of, that book project, music. I haven't really get back to music since I started, here in the film industry, because, I had to make a switch in my life and focus only on making movies.
Mm-hmm.
So right now I started to have a little free time to do other things because of my kids. I have two kids, that grew up with me as a single dad is, you know, a single parent.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had to make sure that I manage my time accordingly. So what's the most feasible thing for me was my the movie business, because, you know, it gives me the space that I need to take care of them and to make sure, like, you know, that I was there for them,
right.
You know. So that's what it is for me right now. It's like feature film productions. I have another script called Little Entanglements, and we're trying to get some major names in Hollywood involved. We are in talk with them. So, I mean, from time to time, we will have updates. I would say, I would advise people to follow my Facebook page.
You're such a wealth of knowledge and inspiration to myself and to those who are listening. What advice would you give to someone who's starting out? They've not even purchased their first camera. They want and aspire to be, not for the accolades, but for the joy of doing it. They want to be where you are. What advice would you give them?
Thank you, TJ Speaks, for your kind words. I really, truly, you know, appreciate it. In terms of advice, I always feel like if you have it like a magnet, that will push you towards the right direction. However, I think it's important for people who want to start or who wants to get into this business who haven't done anything yet, just to be aware of that this industry is based on rejection. You're going to get a lot of rejection before you start seeing some doors open. Some people are lucky. They start at a very young age, or they are in the right environment, so they get, you know, opportunities that others don't. But at the same time, it doesn't matter how good you are. Everybody faces rejection in their lifetime. When the rejection comes, don't let it bring you down. Just keep reminding yourself that there will be other doors that can be opened for you.
If I may be so forward, in closing, if you could please state that you are Pat Jerome and you're listening to Basic Talk in your native tongue, I could die happy.
Moi c'est Patrick Jérôme, m'a parlé dans Basic TikTok et puis son gros plaisir pour moi pour mon programme ça. This is Patrick Jerome. I'm happy to be a guest on Basic Talk, and I'm looking forward to be a guest again in the near future.
Any project, anytime.
Sounds great.
Writer, producer, director, cinematic legend and inspiration, Mr. Pat Jerome, thank you for your time.
Thank you, TJ, and hopefully I will get to see you soon.